the, you know, last bit of the sessions, we have now a panel discussion with four very renowned personalities in Mumbai's healthcare, you know, scenario. And the talk and the panel discussion is around technological advances and hospital design, getting it future ready. So we just now saw, you know, from NHS, how NHS is using robots actually in, you know, hospital system. So that probably we'll, you know, hear more of that in Indian circumstance. Let me invite, you know, the panelists one by one. Tusharkumar Desai, Vice President, Project Healthcare, Reliance Industries. Tushar has a rich experience of 22 years in healthcare field in terms of business development, planning, project management. He is a member of ACHE, American College of Healthcare Executives. He is the Vice President and Head Projects Healthcare of Reliance for hospital projects, including the Sir HN Hospital, Mumbai redevelopment, concept to commissioning. He was earlier to that Head of Hospital Projects and National Supply Chain for Wockhardt Hospitals, you know, in early 2000. So Tushar, please, you know, join us on the stage. Give him a round of applause, please. Then we have Mrs. Simi Bhatia, Lab Director, SRL Laboratories, Mumbai. Simi has worked at several prestigious hospitals and universities in US, Germany, and UK in field of surgical pathology and flow cytometry. In past, she has been associated with CMC Hospital, Vellore, Specialty Laboratory, Santa Monica, US, in flow cytometry and autoimmune disease test, Hartford University, US, Padova University, Italy, St. John's Institute, Guy's Hospital, London. I think I'll have to stop. Simi, please come on stage. And currently, since 1997, she joined SRL, and currently she is the Director of Operations Central Clinical Reference Lab at Mumbai between 2011 till now, and I always seek her advice whenever I have to, you know, have a blood test done. She also sends the phlebotomist at home, so that's, you know, that's the other advantage that probably I have. She graduated from LTMG Mumbai, passed MD Pathology from Tata Hospital in 1992. She's also done a hospital management program from Symbiosis. We will also have with us an architect, Bhumika Jeswani, lead architect, Apollo Hospitals. Bhumika has over a decade of experience in healthcare design and planning. As a lead architect with Apollo, she works on developing design solutions to improve clinical services, various movements in a hospital, and space efficiency. She's also actively involved with interior planning, design reviews, and coordination with consultants. Tends to give us sleepless nights at times, you know, when we deal with Apollo. I'm not talking about the boss, though. Prior to joining Apollo, she was working with Premier Architectural Consultancy and was involved in designing hospitals for major healthcare groups like Fortis, Wockhardt, and the Tata Memorial Center. She holds a BArch degree from MS University of Baroda and MSc from University of Reading, UK, with a full scholarship from Felix Trust, London. As an architect, she believes that a clear focus on intangible elements of design can elevate a hospital from simply being a space to becoming a transformative piece of healthcare architecture. Bhumika, please join us on stage. Last but not the least, you know, Mr. Arunesh Punetha, Regional Director, West Narayana Health. Arunesh is a healthcare professional with 24 years of experience in general management, marketing, and operations in healthcare. With, I think, a lot of sales and marketing people now, you know, in the forefront of healthcare, with specific domain expertise in healthcare and medical device organizations. He is the center head for Narayana Multi-Speciality Hospital at Jaipur when they achieved their first JCI accreditation within 18 months of its operation. He is currently the regional director of Western Region of Narayana Health and drives operations of hospitals at Ahmedabad, Palanpur, Raipur, and the latest is the SRCC Children's Hospital at Haji Ali. He has also played a leadership role in marketing strategy and implementation in chronic disease management, led initiatives on enhancing access through implementation of hub and spoke models, been part of new product development teams, and worked closely with key opinion leaders in establishing national treatment guidelines for continuous ambulatory peritoneal dialysis, you know, for failure patients. He has served for organizations like Apollo Hospitals, Baxter India, Sri Satya Sai Institute of Higher Medical Sciences in Puttaparthi. He holds a master's degree in business administration from Sri Satya Sai University, Prasanthi Nilayam. That's good to know, Arunesh. Please join us on stage. And, you know, as he joins in, I would request, you know, first Mr. Lalit Verma to help us give him the award that he missed out, you know, that day there was no one from SRCC who came. So we had this, you know, award for energy efficient hospitals, and they stood third, SRCC third. And Lalit, Apollo Hospitals was first, so I think it's, you know, makes more sense. All right. So let me, you know, start by, you know, talking a little bit about this, you know, technological advances as we are foreseeing, and it's quite good to see that, you know, people from different, you know, specialties are here. I think we've been looking at hospitals, you know, as they were earlier, very white walls, white floorings, very sterile in its environment. And now, you know, I would say, you know, amongst the four, if I walk into the first two hospitals, you know, if you walk into Sir H.N. Hospital, you know, when I first walked in, I just walked out. I thought I come in a hotel. Yeah. Or you go to SRCC, which is a children's, you know, hospital, and completely different, you know, outlook that they have given to healthcare design. Or you walk into the Navi Mumbai Apollo Hospitals, which I had the opportunity to see at the inaugural function, very well laid out, you know, it does, the lobbies of hospitals now it don't look like. But apart from these architectural marvels and other things, there are other technological advances, you know, which are coming in fast and rapid, and I think it's not to take from, you know, our friend from NHS. I think it's the Aster Hospital in Kochi, which has started to use robotics in pharmacy, you know, because that's one of the highest throughput work area in a hospital is the pharmacy store, and they're using robots, you know, for delivery of medicine. This is the first time I ever saw. I don't know whether, you know, there are some other we'll know from them. Also, when I went to, say, SRL lab, if you go to their laboratory, 80,000 square feet of a lab, I was quite stunned to see a laboratory of 80,000 square feet, you know, where in 80,000 square feet, people ask us to put in 150 beds, yeah? So that's the kind of lab, you know, which is there. You have genetics, you know, and quite different. You will hear from them. So let me ask, you know, Arunesh, begin with you, and can you share with us what are the kind of, you know, technological advances that you have seen, not only in SRCC Mumbai, but from other, you know, hospitals of Narayana?
Good morning. Good morning. As Dr. Vivek just mentioned, you know, my core competency happens to be operations, and I've been into active healthcare for about 10 years, close to 10 years. Healthcare planning and infrastructure is not particularly my domain, but I do bring in an operations perspective, and purely from that regard, if I were to talk about my experience in the hospitals that I've been associated with, I think, you know, the focus is obviously today, when you talk of Narayana Health, you know, there's a lot to do with efficiency. And going with the efficiency, you obviously don't want to compromise on the output of clinical quality. Now, coming to the children's hospital. Now, children's hospital, an exclusive children's hospital that Narayana Health is into. You know, by itself, you know, when we were doing a modeling on when do we expect to see break even. You know, it works very, very differently from a multi-specialty hospital where you've got an entire spectrum of other specialties. Normally, children's program piggybacks on an adult's program. An exclusive children's program requires a lot of heart, and I think that's what Dr. Shetty has, because he's been very passionate about children's healthcare, and to actually think of bringing that into Mumbai was something very unique. So for this hospital, you know, there has been...
Can I just interrupt you on that, you know, because I was also surprised that entire city of Mumbai has only one children's hospital of that stature.
Right.
And I think in India there will not be more than 10, maybe. You know, Rainbow is the one which has come up. What's the reason of why people don't opt for pediatric, you know, despite the fact that you have almost about 30% population, maybe more between, you know, 0 to 14?
See, the thing is that children are not miniature adults. Child, you know, healthcare for child works very differently from an adult healthcare. And the cost of healthcare for pediatrics and neonates is very different. That's why I mentioned.
Is it higher than adults cost?
It's much higher. And that's why I said it always piggybacks on an adult program. For example.
So at the end of the day, it doesn't make as much profit as an adult hospital.
Yes.
Yeah.
So clearly, it is. It's a question of efficiency. It's a question of expertise. Your clinical expertise. Whether it be surgical or the medical expertise, that you need to focus on the details of your protocols. You need to go through the learning curve quickly, and you need to be able to deliver consistent outcomes. To be able to be far more efficient. So that's the reason. And there are quite a few pediatric hospitals, like the Apollo Hospital at Chennai is a wonderful pediatric hospital. You've got Surya over here. All of them doing phenomenal work. This, the reason why the SRCC children seeks to be different, you know, I don't know why we seek to be different is that we're not, our focus is not very primary and secondary. We're really looking at doing everything tertiary to quaternary. If you're looking at operational indicators, your outpatient initially is not going to be a significant operating indicator for us to feel good or, you know, good about.
So, what's the kind of procedures you are looking at, tertiary and quaternary?
See, the focus in the first phase, we're looking at the cardiac sciences, the neurosciences, pediatric neurology, neurosurgery. Oncology, you know, hemo-onc is a very important and relevant specialty for children. We're looking at orthopedics. Pediatric orthopedics is big, you know, and you have a lot of children born with congenital deformities who require a lot of pediatric orthopedics. ENT, cochlear implants, and the other related abnormalities that need to be attended. Critical care is big, you know. While Surya has done a phenomenal job on critical care, but we do think that both for NICU and PICU, there's so much more that can be done. You know, and normally, you know, you'd see most of our hospitals, including NH, you know, where we have a multi-specialty program, we know how much space we give to a pediatric ICU or an NICU. Now, for our information, in our first phase, we are at a capacity of 207 beds. Out of which 97 beds are just dedicated for critical care, which includes NICU, PICU, and surgical ICU.
So almost about 50%?
About 50% is critical care.
That's very high.
It's very high. But this is...
Then how would, you know, patient who come out of critical care would need an inpatient care also, right?
Yeah, but on an average, what we've researched and found out is that the length of stay... for children is not very high. When you look at pediatric, and most of them would, for example, you're going for a cardiac surgery, they would be anyways there in the critical care, you know, and then...
So the average length of stay in critical care probably is longer, is that so?
In critical care is longer, but other routine procedures for general surgery, for pediatric orthopedics and others, it would hardly be a day or two. And anyways, pediatricians don't like to admit too much as well, which is a good thing, you know, even if you were to... have our own children, we would definitely want to avoid an admission as much as possible. We are okay about it for our parents, but for our children, it's a strict no-no. So
this is more of a surgical.
Yeah, it's going
hospital.
To be more of a surgical and a critical. So the, you know, coming to what we've done for this hospital, we've tried. It's still work in progress, but we're wanting to make it very child-friendly and child-safe. You know, a lot of graphics, so much so that the hospital has been designed on a sea theme. We are just next to Haji Ali, overlooking the sea. So it's been designed on a sea theme. Each floor you know, has a theme, a turtle, a seahorse, an octopus, or a dolphin. So, and you know, across the entire room on that floor, the corridors, you would have that theme. So it's made in very, very lively colors. And the graphics are very beautiful. Children are generally restless. You can't keep a child tied down to a bed, really. And you need to also make, when you're looking at an exclusive children's hospital, you need to take care of the parent, you know. So we've kept that in mind. For the sake of the play areas, there's an entire atrium which we've made for the children in the OP area, which is very pleasantly and nicely designed for children to play. We have that as well as in the inpatient areas, where we've got a separate space just for the children to play. We've got dormitories just for parents. You know, when we do think that this is going to become a major referral hospital in time to come. We're going to have patients coming from all over. Invariably, what we see is that a lot of children who come with congenital abnormalities happen to be from the lower socioeconomic class. You normally won't find a very affluent family coming too often for a congenital abnormality. It's all picked up, you know, in early stages of pregnancy. So those people, when they come from all over to for care into Mumbai, you know, stay is an issue. So we are having a separate area allocated for space. Now, if you look at the design of the hospital, it's not the conventional rectangular or square shape design. It's more like a linear block where we have accommodated atriums for the children to play. And this design has been done to allow for a lot of natural lighting.
Is the hospital fully air conditioned?
It's fully air conditioned.
Even the play areas?
Yeah. It's play areas are cool. You know, they're air cooled, but otherwise it's fully air conditioned. Now, coming back to what I was mentioning is that it's been designed to allow for a lot of natural lighting to come in. And this also, in some ways, while it's still early days, have barely been 5.5 months, we believe going ahead when the hospital runs to capacity, this will help us in doing better on our efficiencies on the energy front. And the air filtration, we've got the, as per the industry standard, we've got the high-end air filtration systems in place, which is even more relevant from a pediatric point of view, because children have more...
catch infection early.
Catch infections, their immunity, especially those who are born with defects, their immunities can...
So what have you done with the AC? You have put filtration or you have put some other kind of...
We've got those high-end HEPA filters and, you know, on the basis of the... which is on par with industry standards, you know. We've got them in place.
Any use of technology for the children? Any...
See, like I told you, this it's work in progress. Our partners are the trust from the SRCC, which is a Society for Rehabilitation for Children's Care. So we are partnering with a lot of institutions overseas also. We're looking to bring in as much technology on the supply chain front, particularly for apart from having efficiencies, also looking at, you know, how we can bring down medication errors as much as possible through the use of technology, the use of when you look at monitoring of ICUs, you're having the eICUs, and you know, you can quickly run past, we've got 25 hospitals, you know, how quickly can we get opinion for a critical case. And more, I think more importantly, we've got such phenomenal talent at the Haji Ali Center. We're looking at them building the pediatric program across the group. So there's going to be a lot of communication happening.
Okay.
So, and on the other areas of efficiency, you know, you have you have the STP treatment water being reused. That's one way of water conservation. Use of solar.
Apart from building engineering, is there anything else that you know you are doing, say for patient care or anything?
Like I.
or you could think about it. Let me just come to Tushar.
Yeah.
You know, so Tushar, yours probably is the, you know, one of the most, what do you call, expensive infrastructure in the city today, if I can say so. I have seen the hospital, so I can say so. And I think you have used a very different, I think there is some fire, you know, for fire you have some different way. What are certain things that you have done differently?
I think, first of all, I would say that it's the passion of the group chairman, Shri Mukesh Ambani, that he has to build anything which is best as per the international standards. The first learning, as far as the hospital is concerned, and Vivek and the entire team will agree, there are certain areas where we don't have any standards yet. So we have to literally work on international standards, and working on international standards and balancing at the time of a cost was a question. But that was a passion, and we worked out. We got practically all the international standards, and I thank all the vendors who have been actually with us in terms of our designing and coming up to the international standards what we had, number one. And I think it's a project of lifetime, because such opportunities one will not get it. I would put it that it's the best infrastructure comparatively in the entire country, one of the best infrastructure. I would break it into three, four areas. One is your IT, which is everybody is going to talk about it. The other is the physical infrastructure. And third is the technology. Like a ICU, the beds become one of the very critical components. And people say that I got 700 beds, or I got 800 beds, or I got 1,000 beds. The first challenge was that can we actually have less number of beds and optimize it for the maximum use? So if you really look at our configuration, we have 350 beds against 23 to 24 ORs, which would be our major ORs as well as our DPN ORs.
23 theaters for 350 beds.
Yeah, we have given an order to HT Labor, which is a German company, for the modular OT.
Let me just hold. How many theaters you have?
Seven
with 207 beds.
207 beds.
How many in Apollo? Washi?
There are 12.
12 theaters with?
370 beds.
370 beds. And this guy has 23 theaters with 350. So what was the, you know?
We are different in that. Is that we had a challenge. Number one, we have a limitation of space. Though we have almost 8 lakh plus area of construction. But we wanted to meet the AI guidelines of the size of the corridors, and which is not mandatory as far as JCI is concerned. But that was the mandate. So when we have to meet those particular standards, accommodating the number of beds was an issue, one. Two, we had a restriction on the height, though we had initially planned a hospital of a higher number of floors, but we had to reduce it because of the FSI issue and the height issue.
How many floors you have?
So we have ground plus 19. So primarily when we are looking at this particular planning, the entire concept went that we created an ambulatory floor, and we created almost around 7 to 8 theaters there.
On the OPD floor itself?
No, there is a dedicated floor which is an ambulatory floor.
Okay.
Which actually takes care of all the procedures which can be done as a daycare. Yes, insurance point of view, there are limitations. If a person wants an insurance claim, he has to stay overnight. So those are the limitations. I think with a period of time, we will overcome that, because insurance will also realize that you don't need to keep those patients overnight. So we have an ambulatory floor, so we have higher throughputs on that. So practically my 350 beds is equal to 550 beds. The theaters what we design are the standard theaters, the modular theaters. And every theater can take care of any surgery. So you did not dedicate it that, yes, this is only for EAD, this is only for urology.
So you can do a heart surgery in...
Yes, and the limitation only for the heart surgery would be your heart-lung machine and 3 domes. So that's the only limitation which we work with. Remaining all the other theaters can be used for anything, including the robotics. So that was one about the theater infrastructure design. Now the question is, the ICU beds are restricted or limited in the city of Mumbai. Then you have a lot of VIP patients and disaster. Though the location of a hospital currently is not a location where we will be getting maximum trauma cases, like what we have in a Sion hospital, which has the inflow from Nasik side or Pune side and other areas. But the ER design is a hospital within a hospital. So which is equipped with your CT, theaters, everything. So you can take care of it. And this experience has come from the bomb blast what we had at Opera House. And we landed up with almost around 50 patients at that particular time. With a very small casualty in old hospital, what we had, which was hardly around 2,000 square feet. Today we have 20,000 square feet being allocated only to the ER.
I see. So you have a operation theater, you have...
I got an operation theater, I got an X-ray, I got CT.
Inside of the ER?
Yes, plus the ambulatory beds as well as the ICU type of a bed.
Is that the only CT and you have another CT for...
We have got total 5 CTs in the hospital.
Wow.
Now coming to that, the fact is that I'm coming to the ICU. Now ICU beds are less in the city. At a given time, you know, it's a relative is like a husband's waiting out of the labor room. So in an ICU, the patient relative is actually anxious. We have all the ICUs based on the international standards of natural light. Plus every single room in the hospital can be converted to the ICU.
So how many ICU beds you have?
We have totally around 100 ICU beds. Out of that, all the single rooms what we have in the hospital can be converted to the ICU. So it's a matter of a technology, Philips technology what we have adapted. So getting the monitors, equipments, dialysis in the room is possible. Every a single room along with an ICU can be treated as a dialysis also. So there is an ICU dialysis and ventilation is possible. Plus the presidential suite. Because this thing has come over a period of time that you get certain clientele. And those particular clientele, you cannot just keep it in an ICU room because there's a family, there's other security issues. So we have taken care of that. So technology has helped us to build an infrastructure which can be optimally utilized in a given particular time. Accident happened once, but that for once we should be ready. That's the philosophy. The other element what is important today from a perspective, like you said, the hotel. It's not a hotel, it's a feel of being at home. Because I think earlier we had a sterile corridor, we had white stones, white dresses, a typical smell in the hospital. And even today, people don't want to go to the hospital or there is a fear of going to the hospital. So I think to eliminate this part of it, I think we have to be very friendly, patient friendly, home friendly, like what Arunesh was mentioning about the theme. I think that theme is very important. And I think giving a comfort to the family is also one of the very important aspects. And the statistics what I come across, I meet people is, once within the hospital, they are the fan of the hospital. The other is the service and the hospitality part. The pneumatic tube is a very common thing now. But what we have got is the completely a soil linen and the hospital waste management system, which is a pneumatic system.
I see.
And that's the technology, I would say. So you will not find actually a soil linen moving out from the corridor where the patient is. The pneumatic system won't work unless somebody who is authorized will actually put their barcode badge and the system would go and that soil linen would go to the soil linen area through the pneumatic system.
It's not a chute, it's a...
It's a completely a pneumatic system. And the waste management system what we have, based on the segregation rule of dry, other waste and the soil, again through the authorized person, there is a separate system for that and it will go to the respective area. So you don't have actually the waste management or a soil linen, trolleys moving into a different place. It's a technology and this is ready for the newer buildings even if we come across within the campus.
Can I just curiosity sake, what's the cost of these kind of things?
I don't handle the commercial
okay,
part.
Okay, all right. All right, passed. All right, coming to you, Simi, you know, we were...
One more thing, yeah? Actually, I need to add, because this was actually mentioned about the air conditioning and the public area. I think the future is what we talk about is the air changes in the public area. It's not only the filtration, but the air changes. 2001, when I was with Wockhardt, and I'd been to Harvard because of the Wockhardt Association, I walked into the theater because I wanted to see surgeries from a commercial viewpoint of it. And I was looking like any typical Indian, the shoes. Where are the hospital shoes? The operation theater shoes, and I could not see any. So I was just walking barefoot in the change area, and a lady walked in. I didn't know whether she was a doctor or she was a nurse, but she was a lady there. And she said, that why are you barefoot? I said, sorry, I'm looking for OT shoes. Wear your shoes and go into the theater.
I see. Without a cover?
Without a cover. It was like a surprise for me. And I walked in. That was retina surgery, which a doctor was performing on a three-eyepiece microscope. I was the observer trying to see what is there in the theater, what's the infrastructure, and what commercially walks in. Because of my pricing, what I want to learn. When I walked in and I asked them, they said, that's the environment. Because our environment hygiene is much cleaner. You can walk in barefoot. Certain areas, yes, they ask us to wear the cover. Indian condition, when we look at the epidemiology, the AC is becoming a problem also in the areas like Girgaon, Kalba Devi, and you have a lot of disease conditions, lung disease condition. So the filtration of the public area, air changes is important. Air condition is needed, but the filtration. So you need to create 2 to 4 air changes in the public area. Furthermore, what we have done is that CO2 monitoring in the public area. So that helps us to analyze what is the amount of CO2.
Are you a green building rated? Or?
Yeah, we are already green building and we have already got the LEED certification.
I see. What is the level? Silver, gold?
It's a gold level.
Gold. Okay. So can we walk into your theaters with footwear or no?
Indian environmental hygiene does not permit.
Does not permit. All right. Okay. Yes, Simi, coming to you, you know, just changing the track from hospitals to laboratory.
Yep.
How have you seen, you know, a laboratory embracing technology or, you know, getting more futuristic?
Let me go back to 20 years back, because I joined SRL 20 years back, and the concept of a reference lab never existed. So when I interviewed and I went to this lab, which was about 20,000 square feet, I was pretty amazed because it was just a huge room with divisions of different lab sections. Because pathology was never considered to be different sections. People just thought of a small lab which catered to biochemistry, hematology, serology, and things like that. And this was the first lab where we had sections dealing with flow cytometry, molecular, microbiology, and the way the rooms were designed was very different. 20 years down the line, as you mentioned, the lab has grown from 22,000 square feet to 80,000 square feet. So when we look at what has happened in pathology is that people, what I mean by people is clinicians as well as the patients have realized that the way clinicians are subject matter specialists, you can also have pathology, lab medicine to be subject matter specialists. And that's the reason why today a lot of pathologists are known as hematologists, histopathologists, there is MD biochemistry, there is MD microbiology existing, and there are people doing fellowship in molecular biology. So that is how the need for a pathology to also be oriented to a technology came into existence. Now when we look at a lab of this big a strength, why do you make a lab which is that huge? Would an HN hospital give 80,000 square feet to a lab? No. No hospital would give that, because at the end of the day, what makes money is your bed per patient. And the lab definitely is a golden goose if you get volumes. So anybody can buy the instruments. Anyone financially sound can give you an infrastructure of a space. But then it is the volumes of samples which drives you to get new technologies and keep adding tests. So that is where SRL came into existence as first a reference lab of catering to different technologies and different test menus. Like we have about 5,000 tests with different technologies into existence. Now when you have something like this, what is critical is your processes, because nothing can be person related, then the entire system falls down. It has to be process driven. So whether there is a Simi in SRL today and tomorrow she's not there, it's the process which has to be strong and somebody else can take it on. So when I look at a laboratory, what are the three main critical things? the process, the sample and the instruments. However, when I look at how SRL has dealt with this to ensure that we are the largest lab which is catering to quality standards is pre-analytical, analytical and post-analytical phase of a reference lab, which does not exist in a hospital-based lab. Because in a hospital-based lab, you're getting sample from your ward, you don't have those issues. So how does all this fall into place? And as I said, instruments, infrastructure, if you have financial backing, you can get it. What are the two main pillars then to make these systems work? And one is your logistic system, and the second is your IT, which plays a very, very critical role in ensuring that you can deliver. When we look at logistics is going to support getting your samples in at the earliest, because you have to maintain your turnaround time. Otherwise, you are not in competition, because if I have to get sample from Leh, Ladakh to Rameshwaram, I need a network which is going to give me samples at the earliest. That will help me in beat local competition. And then to get the reports with equal speed, and that's where IT will give me support. Logistics will also help me in ensuring that my inventory management is maintained. Because again, you have different vendors giving you different kits. Today, luckily with GST, things have become simpler as well as complex. But before the GST arena, you had different rates at different parts of the different states. So for us, our costs were very different in different parts. Delhi was cheaper than Mumbai as far as the cost per reportable result. So we had to streamline all those processes. So when I look at what were the challenges we faced and where IT helped us, let us start with the first most important thing is to have a timely flow of information. What do I mean by that? It means if anyone is giving a sample anywhere in the country, as soon as the sample is given, that information comes to the processing unit. So for me at SRL, the sample collection point and the processing unit are two different things. So it is the IT which helps me in ensuring that because of my centralized lab information system, as soon as the sample gets accessioned or gets into my system, that data comes into the main reference lab. So this is your inflow, and outflow is the patient result. So it has to be real time. As soon as the result is ready, the patient should be able to have that information and the doctor should be able to see that report. And that's where web-based reporting and email reporting comes into play. So your IT plays a very important part in ensuring these processes.
So do you still give, you know, reports in envelopes, or everything is emailed?
That depends upon you. So if I have a senior citizen who does not have the feasibility of being able to download reports, I will give him a hard copy. But we insist.
So do you courier it, or it has to be collected?
Again, if they want it to be couriered, we do that. And we do not take any extra charges. So it just gets, you just have to give your address and it comes to you. But it's like this, a courier will come the next day. If the report is ready at 5, and if you have a doctor visit at 6 in the evening, then they would most definitely come and collect a hard copy of the report.
And do you also have, you know, I mean, if it is an internet-based, web-based, we will get previous reports also?
Yes. So that's where we have started, is a unique identification number. And you will not only get your web-based report, but for certain parameters like blood glucose, glycosylated hemoglobin, PSAs, where monitoring is important, you'll get your complete graph, which says when you did what and what was the level. So that's a tracking system that IT has developed. We have a mobile app system, because today everyone wants to be online. So you don't have to come to the laboratory to order your test. You can order your test, request for a home collect, and a phlebotomist comes to your house. He knows what tests need to be given. You get a call which says this is the prerequisite. You need to be fasting. You don't need to be fasting. All those details are given. We have to collect your urine sample. So we give you the details. If urine has to be collected, we send you a urine container beforehand, so that the day you have to give your sample, it's all complete.
That's also couriered, or
No, we handle it. Yeah, it's couriered, but through a local person. So all that happens. So timely and accurate information flow is important both in and out. for report delivery. Turnaround time maintenance, all these things, a bidirectional interface of equipments helps us prevent any manual entry, because suppose I have 100 tests to be done. I do not want my scientific staff to finish all of that and then go to a PC to enter reports. That will take a lot of time. So bidirectional interface means real time. As soon as your result is ready, it's into your information system, and from there it is emailed as well as it can be got on the web. Similarly, for customer satisfaction and care, as I mentioned, you have email reporting. We also have, now who's a customer? Not just the patient, even a doctor. So we send SMSs on your report is ready. We have critical call-outs. So you get an SMS that this is a critical value which needs to be taken care of. For instance, today with swine flu and dengue, everyone wants to know as of yesterday, what is the report? So you have an SMS through IT. You also can have cost efficiencies by streamlining your business proposals. So instead of having a test requisition form which is manually entered, e-filling of those reports. You just have your data, and once captured, next time you mention your unique SRL number and the entire data is there for us.
Okay.
Similarly, manual entries have gone. Tracking of reports can be done. Inventory, so you can have centralized systems like IT, your reagents. You don't have to buy at all different places. You can have a central inventory, because when you buy from a vendor one kit for the entire SRL network, definitely there's cost efficiency. If you buy it at multiple places, the volumes get divided. So that also really helps you, because if you get cost efficiency in your system, you can pass it on to your customer.
Right.
And at the end, compliance to all your regulatory norms. So an IT can help you in data archival, which is very important, as well as in information security, because confidentiality of data, of patient data, is very, very important. Okay. All that can be done. So this is which takes care of whatever you can do for a customer, which I mean is a patient as well as a doctor. But internally also, IT helps us a lot, because it helps us in defining our KPIs, key performance indicators. Now I want
I'll come to the IT part of it in the second round. Can I take you on Bhumika now? And Apollo is known to be, you know, the leader in healthcare, as much as I have known 1986 when Apollo was born. Is there anything that, you know, Apollo is at a group level doing differently for projects, you know, when they are setting up hospital buildings?
See, there are two things to technology. One is project side and one is operation side. So as you all know, that technology changes every year, and projects take 2 to 4 years to build, and they last 25 years. So from project side, we ensure that our projects are ready for future. Like, we work closely with IT team, and we talk to them as to what kind of flexibility they want. We ensure that everything is built in from the start, so that when technology comes, we are already ready to accept it.
Can you give some example? Of
For, you know, our all ICUs, we don't segregate it SICU, MICU, anything. Our all ICUs are standard. All have equally, they are all data connected, PACS ready. We even make a provision that in case, although we have nurse stations in the center directly overseeing the ICU patient, we also give a camera provision. So that in future, if something comes up where...
For each bed, each ICU.
Each bed, we keep it ready. So, you know, next year if my IT team comes to me and says that, you know, I have a camera which can give me some data, or then we say, okay, you just open up the ceiling and plug it in, you are ready to go. So that's kind of flexibility we try and build in. Not only for IT work, but also project planning wise, like we make a grid really flexible, so that our slabs are flexible, we can change departments, and you know, all that thing is built from start, so that we are future proof. Because
So what's the kind of grid you work with?
We work from 8.5 to 9 meters of structural grid. So that gives us flexibility of putting an OT in the center, 600 square feet. So that's.
So does that make a building a little more expensive, 8.5 to 9, or?
We don't look at expense, because that's a cost you bear when you're thinking about future. So, you know, it's give and take. What would I do if I make a small building and tomorrow with telemedicine coming up and you don't need that many hospital beds, what would you do then? So
I think what she's saying will be music to architects' ears, right? That you need owners like these, you know, who really let, yeah, okay.
So and that's the thing that we do projects wise. Then operations side, as everyone said that, you know, you have your unique UHID number and you can access your lab reports, your test reports anywhere, anytime if you have that number. And now we are developing with a concept of a smart room. Like we just did a prototype a month back in our hospital where you can connect your lights, everything to voice control, and the patient can say, switch on lights, switch off lights, open curtains, close curtains.
Wow.
And that works. Like we did a feasibility and we are just doing it in one of our presidential, like three of our presidential suites in Navi Mumbai for trial. And we'll see how the feedback comes and how that goes. So
that works what? With some kind of a remote help?
Yeah, it's like, no, there's a speaker which is next to your bed.
Okay.
And then all the switches are interconnected. So you just give a command that, and that speaker will recognize your, it's your, like your phone, Siri or Google, okay, Google do this.
It doesn't need any training? Siri needs a training.
No. Now with advanced, softwares coming up and, you know, continuously Google, Microsoft are developing their voice recognition software. It's very easy because we tried with different accents in our hospital and it worked with everything.
Any use of, you know, what he was mentioning about garbage disposal systems?
No, we don't have a disposal system, but we have a chute ready just in case in future if it comes. We have a linen chute ready. We have made a provision, but we're not installing it just for capital costs because it takes larger time, but we make it future proof. In case the costs come down with competition starting, we are ready to go.
Okay. Any new experimentation with, say, finishing materials or, you know, anything of that sort in any areas or like what my friend from NHS in the morning was saying, NHS works with a specified, you know, material listing, you know,
yes.
That any NHS hospital, say in ICU, correct me if I'm wrong, will have four types of floorings and, you know, coverings and lights also. They have, you know, pre-described lumens and lux of light, that 20 types of lights, you know. Is the Apollo works like that? Or?
Apollo is developing that. Now, if you will, like for the last 3-4 years, we are doing that. We are sanitizing our finishing. Like in ICU, we'll have vinyl, we'll have a clean room fitting. All those things are getting standardized now. We are, like, if you go to our Navi Mumbai hospital or you go to another hospital in Hyderabad, you'll start seeing that they are getting renovated to the recent finishes.
Current standard.
Yes.
Okay. So, Arunesh, any more, you know, to share in terms of IT in particular? I mean, I'm looking at something like how she mentioned or how we mentioned, something, you know, which is, since you're a pediatric hospital, are you thinking of something which is focused only on pediatric population using IT or, you know, anything like
specific
this?
Specific to interventions in IT, I think all the groups today are extremely aware that, you know, that this is the future. You know, I briefly mentioned about use of IT and technology in the ICU space. There's a lot happening even on the documentation front by way of EMR and health record. And more importantly, you know, there's a lot of data that you get in a hospital, but what do you make, do you make use of that data? So we've got, we've got a complete department which is working on analytics and, you know, ourselves seeing that, you know, if we can get into the predictive analytics space and, you know, support our clinicians with more data. See, the, you know, so that is one thing that we are working on. The other thing is that if you look at, ICUs, and given that all of us are JCI or NABH accredited, there's a lot of documentation happening. You know, everybody is writing, and invariably if you see a lot of clinicians, you know, one of their major resistance to quality accreditation is the amount of documentation that's happening. So another area where we're working on is that how can you minimize documentation in an ICU area where we are working with some of our partners to develop technologies where you know, you can get some of those core parameters that are being monitored at the bedside, you know, that can you know, directly be you know, used as a part of a patient record, and there are very convenient ways of monitoring that rather than the nurse, you know, bedside continuously writing away. She needs to be spending most of her time.
So are you using some kind of, you know, nowadays lot of, you know, hospitals, I think there is a
iPads and
started to use that?
Yes. So this has not been done in our hospital yet, but it's being done at the Health City at Bangalore.
Okay.
You know, and there are a lot of these initiatives which are being piloted across. You know, there's something that's being done at Bangalore, the predictive analytics that's being done at Kolkata. You know, Dr. Shetty himself is a very, he advocates the use of technology whenever he meets the clinicians or others. So I think over the next 2 years, we see a lot of innovation technology that will be, you know, consistently deployed across the network. We are hoping to go at least 70% to 80% paperless, you know, and that way it's going to
this pediatric look, you know, an area where home healthcare might work.
I think yes, especially because we are looking at a lot of high end you know, specialties. For example, recently we had an H1N1 patient who was admitted for about a month or more, was an ECMO, required intensive rehab at home. You know, so you know, we're having the physiotherapist go at home, and
this is very different to handle a pediatric case at home.
Yeah. So you know, getting into a pediatric space, you know, you need to look at everything pediatric. A radiologist with experience in pediatric and interest in pediatric, intensivist, whether it be anesthetist, who are interested in pediatric, nursing. You know, nursing is the most challenging thing because you know, there is a huge demand for pediatric nursing, and you know, getting them to stay for a longish period of time is a challenge. So every hospital is working on their own retention programs. Training is going to be a very important element of you know, any hospital
any
today.
Hospital.
So that I'm maintaining a pipeline of you know, healthcare caregiver personnel.
So I'm throwing it open for questions from audience. Anyone would like to ask any question?
I think Vivek, I would like to add a little bit on this.
Yeah, I have one more question for you. So let me just pick, you know, if there is anyone wanting to ask.
Section of the panel, we heard about a lot of technology and so many advancements which are taking place in healthcare in the private sector or the corporate sector sort of hospitals. I've not been able to encounter such in terms of government hospitals. How are government hospitals are?
No, I think you're wrong, you know, but
yes,
I mean,
a lot of PPP projects coming.
Yeah. So let me just share with you, and then I'll, you know, ask her also to contribute. So, you know, AIMS, which is in Delhi, you know, has started to give appointments, you know, on a mobile phone, okay? Because AIMS deals with about 10,000 to 12,000 patients, outpatients a day, you know. So they have come up with that. Lot of IT innovation they are doing. They are changing their entire air conditioning system using Hitachi technology, and they are looking at bringing down their, you know, electricity cost only owing to air conditioning from about 48 crores per annum. Okay, to about 15 crores per annum. It's not that, you know, and like I said yesterday also, all hospitals that they are looking at now have to be Griha 5. I mean, if he's saying BAM 5 is difficult to reach in NHS, they are, you know, they want Griha 5 compliance for all new AIMS hospitals which are coming up. So it's not that government is not, it's central air conditioned building. Yeah.
Hello. Yeah. My question is to Simi ji. Basically, we are designing a large blood bank. It is a center of excellence for transfusion medicine. And one thing I found very critical is the keeping of the record, 5 years and 10 years, something like that, where signed copies of reports have to be stored. So what is the latest situation and, say, updation regarding this?
Well, actually, none of the accreditation bodies want hard copies. If you have soft copies, but properly attested and kept, it is acceptable. Second, as you are aware, in the city of Bombay, you do not have that much space. Even we as CAP accredited laboratories, for certain of our sections, we have to keep for 10 years. So you do have people who are outsourcing your paper. They keep it for you, they archive it for you at a particular cost, and as and when you want to get it, they'll give you those papers. So they are fantastic outsourcing bodies who will do that work for you, but it is at a cost.
Coming to you, Tushar, you know, two things. One is use of IT. I'm sure you guys must have spent hell of a lot in IT as well. And second is you also run on a private basis. You are, I guess, you are owner of a small hospital. I keep getting WhatsApp messages.
Little correction. Actually, that's a family project.
Okay, family project. So, from a, you know, a mega project to a small boutique hospital, is there any change that you see, and, you know, is the infrastructure need requirements, you know, is around same, or everything gets scaled down?
No, I think even that actually answers one question which was coming to the government sector. It's the attitude which is important. And I think if there is an inclination, you can actually still deliver the quality. Talking about the IT space in Sir HN Reliance Foundation, I think I can tell you that we are actually an IT focused organization, and with Jio also, we are almost working extensively on IT. But when we created SRHN, Jio was actually in the planning phase. So apart from the standard IT, we started working on the paperless and stuff like that. Big challenge in India, overseas, everywhere. Doctors and politicians are same worldwide.
Don't say that. Don't say that.
Of course, we are also doctors, but then the fact is that their attitude of...
But the politician image probably with Mr. Modi is going to change, you know, so that
What I mean by doctors is that they are resistant to actually use the gadgets. They are resistant in writing. They prefer dictating or probably, and their handwritings are becoming an issue. So we tried, and I think we have been successful. We have this iPad system which is working. So we have given training to our doctors, even the senior doctors.
So iPad for what purpose?
For all their patient entries.
I see.
They go on the rounds, there is an iPad, there is a resident doctors with an iPad, so that's compatible with our HIS. We have tried a little different, you know. We have not gone for a conventional HIS, which has been sold. We tried Cerner, Epic, everything. But the issue was, one was the server farms what they require and the implementation time. So since we have an enterprise contract with SAP, and SAP do have the medical side of it, which in India they were not promoting the medical component of it, so we got the combination of SAP as well as a medical component. And the only thing which was missing was LIS. So we got an LIS from another agency. Coming to, the radiology and I think the pathology has been the forefront in this technology, you know, acceptability, and they are actually using it extensively over the period of last two decades. So we have, but then comes the patient entertainment system and the patient care system. So even in the room, for example, if it's a twin sharing room and we keep one TV, then there is always an argument between two patients that kya dekhna hai, kya nahi dekhna. So we have two TVs in a twin sharing room. Now the question is the noise, the volumes. So we got actually a special piece of actual system. So patient entertainment system, which is in hospitality related, plus there is a speaker or the gadgets where only the patient is listening to the channel. So it is not disturbing to the other patient. The other use of an IT is RFID and DSCC, where what are we looking at is man and material. So if I have to trace Dr. Vivek Desai, and he is not reachable at a particular location over a phone, probably my IT can help out with his particular RFID that he is sitting in so-and-so location. So we can actually help that. Plus, all the equipments are also tagged. So locating those equipments, the material movements, everything is being tagged by the RFID tag. Coming to, I think, the most important thing, like you have raised about the pediatric home care. I think the home care is becoming very, very essential, because Now the criticality of the patient who requires a monitoring. So the use of the set-top box, what we have it for a TV. Mm-hmm. Now use of the set-top box or an Android apps or any other Apple apps is something which is becoming an in thing and people are working towards it. So your smaller gadgets which are now available in the market could directly be connected and linked up for monitoring purposes. So your ECG, the small ECGs and other monitoring.
So are you doing that or not yet? No, I'm asking him. Are you doing it? Yeah.
No, we are right now in the stage of actually a testing mode. And that's not been done at the hospital, that's been done at the offsite.
Okay.
So that's something which is very important. So IT will play a very important role. And lab as, sorry, I'm entering in your area. But the thing is that for a hospital, the focus is a hospital. And for you, it's a focus business of a laboratory. But even the technology in terms of robotics is very important. And the other element which, at the last I would like to speak, which you mentioned right in the beginning at your opening remark, was the use of robotics in pharmacy. I think we have evaluated that particular system. The FDA norms, if it works out and if adopts certain system of a unit-based dispensing to the patient, then I think it will become one of the very important component which will avoid wastage of medicine. And then that particular robotic would help us because the central store plays a major role. But I think you need to have this sheer size of that business to actually implement that particular system for a viability. So,
just one last question for you, Bhumika. Is Apollo looking at pre-engineered hospitals? Why you are not looking at it? I mean, everyone says pre-engineered, faster, better. Cost probably is not going to be an issue considering people like Apollo or HN or even, I think Narayana has used it in Mysuru. There is a hospital which they have built with L&T. Is there any move towards that or still not thinking of it?
It's just that pre-engineering has its pros and cons. Like if pros, it's saving time and it's keeping a cleaner side. But then there is a con also. Like when we plan a hospital, we think about patients, the ambience, their relatives, doctors, staff, lighting, all that. So we come up with designs. Now pre-engineering will adopt the design to fit their standard assembly procedures, which are, you know, efficient for them. So the result is that if our design is not suitable for them, they'll ask some changes to be made. Now as a designer, maybe it's like containing your creativity in a way. So till such time where the pre-engineering is not advanced enough to adopt any flexibility.
So what you're saying is if it's a cookie cutter only, then it works better.
Yeah, it's
creativity gets killed.
Yeah, but pre-engineering can play a big part in, you know, developing some smaller things like you can say toilet, pre-engineered toilets, you come and install them, it saves time. Or you can say facade panels, or you just say the fixed structure, the concrete shell. So you can pre-engineer them and individual elements and bring them in rather than pre-engineering the whole design with, you know, everything inside and putting it on site. So I think that would work better in terms of not restricting creativity and bringing that element of pre-engineering into your design.
Right. Simi, you were to say something about IT when I cut you off.
I was just adding that IT is also important for internal purposes. What is your turnaround time analysis? So that helps you in keeping a section on the toes that yes, on a daily basis, you haven't met your turnaround time.
Well, how do you benchmark it? Is there a benchmark for that or?
Oh, well, one would want 100%, but that would never happen because you have reassays happening. You may not have a clinical history. So you're looking at what is the area. For instance, if it is routine biochemistry, I think it should be about 95% to 97%. You will not have that many reassays. And if there are reassays, you need to find out the reasons and then build in a level of confidence that if
you're
getting
the same. So how much is the reassessment rate at your lab?
Less than 1%.
Less than 1%?
Yeah.
That's very good.
Yeah. And that's one of my KPI. So problem samples, turnaround time, reassay percentage, these are monitored on a weekly basis by each section head and then to the lab director.
Anything about building infrastructure that you in lab one has to keep in mind or?
Yes, the process flow of how a sample is going to come into the laboratory, the different processes it's going to take, and the outcome. Because you cannot.
So how many samples you get a day?
Only in the reference lab, Mumbai, it's about more than 5,000 on a day basis. Yes. So that's important. So decentralization of processes, like accessioning at the point, so that when it comes into the ref lab, you just are doing an acceptance and sending the sample through the pneumatic chute. Because wherever human intervention can be prevented, will help you in delivering the results on a timely basis, lesser errors, and better reports.
Okay. So any question from, yeah.
I want to add some data from the government sector that you were asking for. I'm from PGI Chandigarh. So we there are right now proposing a pneumatic chute for a 250-bedded hospital. We are also adding, because there are several number of buildings in PGI Chandigarh, so we are connecting our research blocks. We have two research blocks, A and B. So we are connecting them to the main Nehru Hospital via, we are proposing it via Nehru Hospital, and that will be around a 4 kilometer long chute system that will be required. And see, technology, what the problem we are facing is that the patients that we are handling, they come from a very poor background. So for them, IT and setting up IT system is a bit difficult, but we have that in our internal system. We have that for the doctors, for the engineering staffs as well. We can report our problems on the SMS systems. PJ has started up centralized registration that can is through an online portal, and that happened around a year back. So hospitals, government hospitals are advancing in technology. Things do get stuck up somewhere in the files and somewhere, but there is an advancement that is going on.
In fact, they should use technology more, because the amount of volume they deal with is very difficult.
We need a lot of technology, because as ma'am is, I totally agree with ma'am, pathologists in our departments are very highly respected for the work that they're handling. They get around 8,000, 10,000 samples per day. And our OTs, that was being discussed yesterday, our OTs don't get time to even shut off.
Wow.
We have to very highly manage them, that when
to it literally them. Works round the clock?
Yes, our ATCs, ATC traumas are working round the clock.
How many theatres and how big is the hospital?
It's PGI Chandigarh, it's PGI. In 2 lakhs, it's more than 5 lakh square meters of area. And there are probably around 23 OTs in different buildings. We have 10 OTs coming up, and then there is a proposal for 20 more OTs.
And how many bed hospital?
2,000.
2,000 bed, 23, kaise possible hoga? Hamara to 350.
That's what I'm saying.
No, no, I'm saying that, you know, hamare to.
I agree with the facts. No, the facts.
Yeah, but you know, 2,000 beds, 23 is too less.
It's absolutely very less.
It will need.
Sure, sure. We're coming up with 30 more OTs now.
If we have time, can I just add on to this?
Sure.
You know, there are a lot of PPPs happening, at least I know of pathology and radiology, like Jharkhand, Himachal, UP. About 4 months back, Maharashtra government came up with PPP. Unfortunately, what's happening is, as they are getting expertise and experience of the PPPs, they realize where the private partner is making some amount of money. And today they have come up, because it's one central body who's responsible for, you know, going to different states. So when SRL has 3 PPPs under its portfolio, but when we came with Maharashtra, we were very skeptical, because what they feel is that they should get everything FOC. So if that happens, it's going to be very difficult to maintain the standards. But trust me that the way things are happening in Himachal, remote places which they would have never thought healthcare could be there, where it was zero. Today, at least we can say we've got it to level 5. Level 10 would be very difficult, because you just can't have the same infrastructure over there. And one thing very important is the man behind the machine. We all forget that. We all, as corporates, do not give value to the human resource. And that's one thing that should never be forgotten. So for us to get a human resource in a city of Mumbai is much, much easier. Today, still difficult, if I want of a particular level. In those remote areas, it's just next to impossible.
Sure.
question to Tushar.
Yeah.
You just mentioned regarding having 23 operating theaters and facilitating the ambulatory care. Yeah. Is there a sort of a larger sort of public awareness of what is ambulatory care and how can ambulatory care actually release you more space in the existing hospital than sort of bed blocking?
I think it's a very good question. You know, we talk about future and we talk about the future ready, but the reality on a grassroots is totally different. The awareness starts actually from the level of a doctor. So what the doctor actually understands about the concept is something which is very important. Then is actually the referring doctor. The third is our patient. Patient gets a lot of information and misinformation from Google Baba and WhatsApp Guru. So that's again a big challenge for us. So
I like that, Google Baba. Yeah.
So fundamentally, you know, I'll give you an example without quoting it. At one of the locations, certain things which was done as an technology which is regularly, routinely being used in UK and US. And I said, okay, this is what is the type of a consulting room. And I have my colleague behind you who is right now with Apollo. And both of us have actually tried working on different models. And believe me, we were forced to change those models to the basic Indian models.
Yes.
So it's the doctor who needs first an awareness, the education. And they need to change. That's one. Creating such an ambulatory, believe me, it's a tough time. First is to convince the doctor. The second is to convince the patient. Coming to the question which Dr. Vivek had asked me about the small hospital which is owned by our family. We have the similar equipmentations as like any other contemporary hospital. And there a very senior doctor and who performs more than 1,000 joints in a year in different hospitals in the city, who also operates there. He wanted to discharge a patient after a knee replacement on the same day evening. And it's a total knee replacement, done very well with his technique. The relative was not ready. The relatives were not ready. He said, sorry, we don't want to get discharged. And he was quite enthusiastic. He said, no, I want to have this. I want to make, because there are selective patients who can go on the same day. It was not possible. So the awareness in the community is also very important. What we talk in the conference and what is on the grassroots reality, these are the two things which we need to balance. Like the ICU rooms, the rooms which are private room ICUs, is an acceptable norm for those who have actually seen the West, but not acceptable for the public who is actually used to with the soft partitions.
No, like go to Narayana, you know, Dr. Shetty believes in a very large format open ICU system, even for children, you know, it works for him. He's tailored his, you know, what you call the trolleys and everything, he's self-designed it, you know, how to go about it. So, you know, it's different ways. So, ambulatory care in India is coming up, it will take time. Like he says, doctor first has to popularize it, he himself is not wanting to do it, it won't happen because he convinces the patient. Yeah, last question.
Regarding in architectural perspective, he was asking about pre-engineered buildings. Is this climatological conditions acting as a major force in curtailing the possibility of having pre-engineered buildings? Because Mumbai is not the same as Bangalore in terms of climatological conditions. Pre-engineered conditions probably will have a same platform or a same module, which may curtail the aspect of climatological aspects to be taken care of.
I don't think so. Climatological would that much effect.
No, if it is an air-conditioned thing,
no,
fine.
That's
but
okay. Pre-engineered means you can, if you're giving a wall panel, you can always design it for suitable insulation and whatever, and you know, fight that climatological condition. The only drawback will be the distance of the factory to your site.
Okay, logistics.
So, yeah, the logistics. So if I have a pre-engineering manufacturer, because there are not many in India right now, he will be coming 1,000 kilometers from that site to the actual site, which is in Gujarat or somewhere. So So that is an issue. Like if you have a manufacturer which is in the vicinity, it makes much more sense than having something transported from 2,000 kilometers into your site. So climatologically, I don't think so that's a restriction.
Okay, on a general platform, I'm asking, one of the major concerns or deaths and incidents are happening related to hospitalization is due to road accidents. You know, on this front, accident trauma and rehabilitation centers, are there as many coming up in India? Are there any specific spaces where it is only being catered to such sort of situations? It's rampant.
So there are two things in that, you know, if you are asking of accident and trauma treatment centers,
with rehabilitation.
No, so just let me finish it. If it is treatment centers, private sector is not willing to look at it because it becomes a medico-legal. You don't know who's going to pay, you know, so private sector generally reluctant to take on those kind of things. In terms of rehabilitation, I think there is, you know, fair amount of movement in private sector. People are willing to set up rehabilitative centers, you know.
It is the norm of the day, or it is very much needed. Well, maybe whatever is the
So from a private sector perspective, it's always the cost benefit analysis. From a government sector perspective, rehabilitation probably difficult for them, you know, to do. They can probably look at it.
Due to these problems, we are actually having a huge shortage of these things happening in any city for that matter.
Right, but it's a policy level, you know, decision. If you want to, you can talk to them offline after the thing and, you know, ask them whether it makes sense to. See, he said first thing was pediatric hospitals are less. Because it doesn't make commercial sense.
But from service orientation, now it is totally becoming a, you know, business oriented center.
I think that's a big debate. So let me just, you know, time this out here itself, because this will never end. Okay. So I think thank you. You know, big round of applause for all the panelists. I'll call upon Vikas, which, you know, managing director of Ideas Exchange, the event organizer. I think Vikas, good job done, I must say, with the conference and the exhibition. Do you agree? So after this is a lunch break, and 2:30 I will request at least all the architects, it's open for all. But all the architects to be present in this room for a competition, you know, for there are 5 presentations, 5 teams, you know, student competition on assisted living center, and we have to judge them. All right, so we'll request.